What I find fascinating about this passage here, you see, a lot of people make, I think, a wrong distinction between sacred work, which is what they assume that I do, and secular work, which is what, as you've heard, most of the leadership in the church do. And they make a distinction and say, well, obviously what someone like David does and now what Warren does, obviously this is sacred, this is holy, this is something that God's Spirit can be at work in them and so on. But other people, they just do ordinary jobs.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Holy and Anointed, Exodus chapter 30 verse 1 to 31 verse 18, by Pastor David Wise.
Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your way that your word has already been active among us this morning. We think of John and the way that your words come into his life. He's responded to you and been baptized this morning. And for others that we're going to see baptized over the next couple of months, made a response to you. Father God, thank you. Thank you, your word is alive and active. So we come and look at this passage now. Father, we ask that you're going to speak to us, not just to help us gain information, but revelation from yourself. You're going to speak into our hearts and our minds and our situations. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're looking at another two chapters from Exodus this morning. You can see them on the screen there, chapters 30 and 31. So if you want to be turning that up whilst I introduce. If you're here regularly, you will have heard this before, but if you're here for the first time, it's important that you understand that Exodus is probably the most significant book in the Old Testament. It's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and as we've been seeing as we work through, to much that is also in the New. It's the Old Testament equivalent of the Gospels. And we've been looking at Exodus now for a year. We started in November last year. We've had various breaks. We're taking a break after today. This will be the last time we look at Exodus until the new year. We're taking a break for Christmas and the new year. We're back into Exodus at some point in January when we will finish the last section of the book. If you've missed any of the sessions, all of the sections of the Exodus teaching are on our website. And it's really good quality sound and picture, and I think it's quite good teaching as well. So do have a look at those. And in fact, we're now in the situation we have more people that watch this teaching on the website than actually are here on a Sunday. Typically, after a couple of months, any sermon's been watched on the website for 200 or 300 times. And some of them actually are up to 700 or 800 now. So it's a good resource. You might want to make use of that. Now, last time we looked, you may recall, at the consecration of the priests. Do you remember that last week? Who was here last week? Excellent. So what were the main things we learned last week? Listen to the question. Not about the Old Testament priests. What were the main things we learned about ourselves last week? Because you remember we noticed that all of us, every one of us who is part of God's family, every one of us who's invited Jesus into their life is a... all of us. And I remember I asked you last week, how many of you here are full-time Christian ministers? How many full-time in ministry? And eventually we got to the fact that nearly everyone's hand was up, because we're all called to serve God full-time, aren't we? So whether we work for the church or whether we work, as Andy was talking about earlier on, for an entertainment company or whoever it is we work for, we serve God full time. And we are priests full time. So what were the main things we learnt about ourselves last week? That was obviously highly educational last week. You haven't had the benefit of being able to have a review on the website either, because last week's teaching's not up yet, so you haven't been able to have a peek this morning. Sophie. Yeah, very, very good. One of the phrases I talked about last week, we are the place where heaven touches earth for the people around us, so we are the priest for God to work through. Anita. Okay, we're precious in God's sight to Jesus. Yeah. What else do we see about priests last week and ourselves? I see a hand. I'm not sure who it's attached to. Oh, Rangina.
We still need to have a daily sacrifice of God, the daily sacrifice of glory.
Yeah. In the Old Testament, they made that daily sacrifice to God of the offerings. And we today, it says in Peter, make daily spiritual sacrifices to God. So we are still serving God. And we looked at what some of those things were last week. Denise?
We're intercessors, filling in the gap for others.
Yes, we have a role in praying for other people, interceding for other people as they brought God's prayers. So we do that as well. Very good. What else? Anything else? Yes, Hannah. Our whole life should be dedicated to serving God. Not just one bit, not one part, absolutely right. Every single aspect and part of life. Let me look at my list, see if... something else as well. Yeah, something else that we're going to come back to later on today that was quite important we saw last time. We saw it in the way the priests were consecrated. Something had to happen to them in their relationship with God before they could function. It has to happen to us as well. Yes.
Anointed.
Yes, anointed. Before they were anointed, what happened to them? Can you remember? You're absolutely right about the anointing. But before they were anointed, they were washed, which stood for the fact they were being cleansed from their sin. And remember, we saw that last time. We saw it was the Old Testament, if you like, equivalent of baptism, some would argue, that the priests, before they were ministered, they were completely washed with water. Only it was a once-only event, which is why many see a parallel between that coming into the role as priests and baptism, as we witnessed this morning. Okay, let's begin then in this passage. And remember, we are eavesdropping on a conversation. We come to the end of that conversation this morning, with the end of the passage we come to. But we are eavesdropping on a conversation. God is on the top of the mountain, Moses is there, and God is talking to Moses. And this is the account of that conversation between God and Moses. And that's what we're listening to. So all the instructions here are God speaking to Moses. So we begin chapter 30 and verse 1. Make an altar of acacia wood for burning incense. It's to be a square, a cubit long, a cubit wide, and 2 cubits high. Its horns of one piece with it. Overlay the top and all the sides and the horns with pure gold, and make a gold molding around it. Make 2 gold rings for the altar below the molding, 2 on opposite sides, to hold the poles used to carry it. Make the poles of acacia wood. Overlay them with gold. Put the altar in front of the curtain that is before the Ark of the Testimony, before the atonement cover that is over the testimony, where I will meet with you. We'll come back to that in a moment. Aaron must burn fragrant incense on the altar every morning when he tends the lamps. He must burn incense again when he lights the lamps at twilight, so that incense will burn regularly before the Lord for the generations to come. Do not offer on this altar any other incense or any other burnt offering or grain offering. Do not pour a drink offering on it. Once a year, Aaron shall make atonement on its horns. This annual atonement must be made with the blood of the atoning sin offering for the generations to come. It is most holy to the Lord. Now, this was a small altar. We're talking about something that maybe was a quarter of a metre, as I remember explaining before, that the cubit was a variable measurement depending on how long the arm of the carpenter was. So we're talking something that maybe is half a metre in each direction, a square, a very small portable altar. And it was placed inside the tabernacle or the tent, but outside the curtain. In fact, it was immediately outside the curtain that separated the holiest place, where the covenant box was, that we talked about before, with its gold covering, above which God said, I will meet with you. It was placed immediately outside the curtain, the other side of the curtains, the covenant box. Outside is this altar of incense. Incense was burnt there twice a day. Now, in the Bible, we're not going to look at the other verses for this, but in the Bible, incense is connected with the prayers of God's people. In fact, it's an image of, as the smoke rises from the incense, the image is of the people's prayers rising to God. And so the altar is placed just outside the curtain, just the other side of that curtain is where God said, above this cover, above this covenant box, or the Ark of the Covenant, if you want the old expression, that's where I'm going to meet with you. So you see the connection here. The incense here, God presencing himself there, saying, your prayers, they're coming straight to me. I'm going to hear the prayers of my people. We're going to pick that up again a little bit later. Let's go on. Verse 11. Then the Lord said to Moses, when you take a census of the Israelites to count them, each one must pay the Lord a ransom for his life at the time he is counted. Then no plague will come on them when you number them. Each one who crosses over to those already counted is to give a half shekel according to the sanctuary shekel, which weighs 20 gerahs. This half shekel is an offering to the Lord. All who cross over, those 20 years old or more, are to give an offering to the Lord. The rich are not to give more than a half shekel. The poor are not to give less when you make the offering to the Lord to atone for your lives. Receive the atonement money from the Israelites and use it for the service of the tent of meeting. It will be a memorial for the Israelites before the Lord, making atonement for your lives. Now, you may recall, going back to early in Exodus, that every firstborn male belonged to God. And that every firstborn male, every son born to an Israelite, the first one born, had to be redeemed via a sacrifice. Do you remember that? A few nods. Now, you may also remember, right back at the beginning of Exodus, that God said, Israel as a nation, the whole nation, is my firstborn son. So the whole nation was regarded by Israel, by God as his firstborn son. Remember, we looked at that when we were looking at the plagues and the death of the firstborn in Egypt and how the symmetry of all that together. So that's the background to what's going on here. This offering, this atonement money that is being paid. But actually, I want to turn it around a little, because I don't want to focus on the money. The money was just a very small payment that was made that was used for the maintenance of the equipping of the tabernacle. But actually, there's something else going on here that for me seems to be much more significant. We're very used, and rightly so, thinking of in the Old Testament. You know, for us as Christians today, we make an individual decision, don't we? In our family, each individual needs to make a decision for Jesus. And that's very much our focus. We're very individualistic. I'm not saying that is a good thing by itself, but it is a reality that is there. So, for example, in the family, we saw John baptized this morning. All the rest of his family, his wife, and all the others within the family that are part of the church here have actually been, they've made their own decision for Jesus. But John had to come to that place. And we saw John baptized this morning, making that decision for Jesus himself. And here we see in the Old Testament an illustration of the way that not only was the whole nation committed to God, but actually each individual needed to make that decision for themselves. So here they had to come to a point, and it's an interesting phrase, where they had to cross over from the people that had not made a personal commitment to God. They had to cross over, they had to enroll, and they paid a nominal price for that, to cross over to those who had enrolled, those who said that they are part of God's people. I think Motcher writing on this, he says this, each one must individually undertake the responsibility, make the decision, and pay the price. So as we think back over the 16 verses we've looked at so far in chapter 30, the incense, we think about here, the crossing over. What do we learn? Because the whole principle behind looking at this is God is the same, isn't he? Amen? Yesterday, today, and forever, God does not change. And human beings are pretty much the same. We are now under the new covenant. This was the old covenant. But the principles that were behind that covenant, as we've seen, actually come to fruition in the new covenant. We've seen all those parallels going through. So what do we take away? What do we learn about ourselves from our situation here in 2008? What do we learn from this about ourselves, from this first half of this chapter? Oh, suddenly all these hands shoot up. Joan.
I love that bit. It says, I will meet with you, and God meets with us.
Yes, I will meet with you. It's that phrase, isn't it? Above the cover. I will meet with you. God meets with us. But of course, we don't have to go just to one space because we now have God in our lives. That's very good. Yes, Joan.
I find this quite complicated, but I wondered if paying the ransom of money is to symbolise in the fact that we all belong to God and everything we have is his, and yet he gives us the choices about how we use our lives, and maybe that's a symbol of saying, actually, God, here's a part of what I owe you.
Very good. I would agree with that. And it's what we do when we give our offerings, isn't it, on a Sunday morning. It's not quite the same, but there's a similar thing. When we give our tithes and our offerings, we are saying to God, all that we have is yours. And we show that by actually giving this much, whether we do it through the plate or bank transfer, however we do that. So it's that same principle that actually we make this small payment. We're saying actually all belongs to you. That's very good. Now, I saw another hand up here somewhere. Was it you? Fosse? Yeah.
I said everybody's equal. It didn't matter whether you were rich or poor.
Yeah, everyone is equal in coming before God. Rich or poor, they come on exactly the same basis. Just like us when we come to Jesus. Doesn't matter how clever we are or thick we are or other people's views of us, whether we're rich or poor. It makes no difference at all. We come to Jesus on the same basis. Was it Timmy?
Yeah, I was going to say the same.
You were going to say the same thing. It's very good. I'll come back to you, Birch. Fiona.
The ransom part is not less.
Okay, so the for us, the ransom has been paid by God, yeah. Whereas for them, they had to pay it. But Jesus has done that perfectly. Very good. And last one on this, Birch.
Yes, at verse 11 there, it said, every man shall give a ransom for himself. I think we all are responsible, each one. No one can give account or excuse.
Yeah.
We must stand that test, each individually, for self.
Yes, everyone has got to make, that's one of the things that I picked up, that everyone has got to make that decision. So for us, the fact that we've been brought up in a Christian family, we've grown up in a Christian family, it doesn't actually make you a Christian. You have to make that decision for yourself. Everyone has got to make that as we go through. Okay, we're going to come back to the incense a little bit later on. That appears in the next section. So let's pick up with this. Let's go down to verse 17. Then the Lord said to Moses, make a bronze basin with its bronze stand for washing. Place it between the tent of meeting and the altar and put water in it. Aaron and his sons are to wash their hands and feet with water from it. Whenever they enter the tent of meeting, they shall wash with water, so they will not die. Also, when they approach the altar to minister by presenting an offering made to the Lord by fire, they shall wash their hands and feet, so that they will not die. This is to be a lasting ordinance for Aaron and his descendants for the generations to come. Now, this basin stood in the courtyard, so it was actually outside of the tent, and it was to be used frequently because the priests needed to stay holy. As we talked about earlier on, they were washed once all over, but they still need, which made them, it was a part with the sin offering, which is again that once only offering for sin as part of their consecration. They were considered holy, but they needed to maintain their purity. They needed to maintain their holiness, because if they entered God's presence in an unholy state, they could die. The priests that God had chosen, that God had commissioned, that had all this stuff done for them, if they entered God's presence in an unholy state, they could die. I wonder what you make of that when you think about ourselves as we come to God, as we worship. I'm going to make some more comments in a moment, but I wonder what reflection that is for you. Because we said earlier on that we worship the same God. God is still the same, yesterday, today, forever. Human beings are the same. So how does this work for us, Steve?
It's no different, because we're all going to get judged. And when we go to him, if we haven't got that relationship with him, we will die in terms of his presence. We'll go to hell.
Okay, so we're all going to be judged. So if you're saying if someone has never become a Christian, they're going to eternal death, which the Bible talks about as hell, separated from God. That is true, but I think there's more than that here. Denzel.
I think it's the same for us in that through Jesus we have forgiveness, but we still continue to sin. So we still, from time to time, need to have our hands and feet washed, as it were, from those things. And this relates to me back to the New Testament, where I think it's James that says, you know, when we're worshipping God, particularly actually in communion, he's referring to, you know, come with clean hands and hearts, because actually some of you are doing it carelessly. You, in a sense, you're sinning. And the consequences are that some of you are actually sick and some have actually died. So there is a kind of parallel.
Yeah, it isn't in James, actually 1 Corinthians. It's in the passage on 1 Corinthians. And it said there that, you know, some of you do not, you come, these are my words, you come carelessly into my presence, carelessly you eat this bread and drink this wine. And because of that, some of you are physically sick and some have even died. Very powerful. Mary.
It's much the same. I was going to say that, but also this isn't speaking to people that didn't have a relationship. This is speaking to priests, isn't it? So it's to us.
Yes.
But I was thinking of that as well, that the communion, that it says some have died because they took it carelessly.
Very good. Hannah.
God still emphasizes on being holy, that even in the Bible it says that doesn't mean just to, for believers and non-believers, that if we have iniquity in our hearts, the Lord will not hear us. So the continual renewal of the mind and living a holy life is important to God for his children.
Yes, so there is that holiness that is, you know, required for us still today. And, you know, we can be, I find these passages really sobering, because, you know, so often, again, I refer to it a number of times in this teaching in Exodus. Now, we here, we would be described, I don't mean we'd be described kindly, but we would be described as a happy, clappy, charismatic church. You know, in our worship, we're lively, we dance, we get excited by God. We're excited by God's presence, and we're very conscious of God's presence with us, God at work in our lives. And, you know, that sometimes can lead to a casualness in the way we approach God. And sometimes it can lead to a carelessness in the way that we can approach God. We see it sometimes. Some of the worship songs, not some of the ones we sing here, but some of the worship songs that I hear sometimes. I've heard them described as Jesus is my boyfriend songs. Do you know what I mean by that? They take a liberty with the closeness of God. They're not. Are you with me? You understand what some of you are nodding. So it's that over familiarity. It's forgetting about the fact that actually God is a holy God, and God does not tolerate sin. And we need to remember that we can't play fast and loose with God. People did that in the New Testament, and some of them died. And God is still the same. And we need to remember that. And the other thing that goes along with that is there's a, 1 John 1 and verse 8. It's our equivalent of the basin for washing. We don't have a, in the church here, we don't have a little basin. You need to wash your hands and wash your feet before you come to worship, because Jesus has died on the cross. But 1 John 1, verse 8 says this. Now, we have a God who is faithful and true and cleanses us from our sins. So we need to come before God and confess our sins and stay holy. We cannot be fast and loose with God, because God will judge us. Even us charismatic, happy, clappy Christians. God is still the same. He's a God of holiness, and we need to respect that in the way that we come to worship him. And it is, you know, we come across this a number of times, and we will see it again in Exodus. We have to take this part of God very seriously, because God is just the same. If it wasn't such a serious issue, God would not have sent Jesus into the world to die on the cross for us. If sin was something that didn't matter, that was a light thing, a thing that could just be, you know, just glossed over, he would not have had to send Jesus into the world to die on the cross for us. And whilst we come to that acceptance and cleansing from sin, there is not a cost to us. We don't, you know, it's free in the sense that we come before God. It actually cost God everything in sending his son. And we need to remember that when we think about this whole thing, about the way that we worship. Now, we are cleansed by confessing our sin. It's why it talks about in that passage in 1 Corinthians, it's 1 Corinthians 12, I think. It's 1 Corinthians 11, verses 29 to 31. It talks about how when we come to communion, we must be serious about thinking about ourselves, examine ourselves. And if there's sin in our life, we need to put it right with God. And that's really important. Let's move on to the next section, verse 22. The Lord said to Moses, take the following fine spices. 500 shekels of liquid myrrh. Half as much, that's 250 shekels, of fragrant cinnamon. 250 shekels of fragrant cane. 500 shekels of cassia. All according to the sanctuary shekel, and a hin of olive oil. Make these into a sacred anointing oil, a fragrant blend, the work of a perfumer. It will be the sacred anointing oil. Then use it to anoint the tent of meeting, the ark of testimony, the table and all its articles, the lampstand and its accessories, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering and all its utensils, and the basin with its stand. You shall consecrate them so they will be most holy, and whatever touches them will be holy. Anoint Aaron and his sons and consecrate them so they may serve me as priests. Say to the Israelites, this is to be my sacred anointing oil for the generations to come. Do not pour it on men's bodies. Do not make any oil with the same formula. It is sacred, and you are to consider it sacred. Whoever makes perfume like it, and whoever puts it on anyone other than a priest, must be cut off from his people. This idea of making this an oil, albeit a beautifully smelling oil, using oil to make something holy is an idea that's a bit strange. Well, it's strange to me anyway. It's an odd concept, how putting oil on something makes it holy. And we need to understand what's going on here. It's not some magic rite or some magic ceremony. What it is here is a recognition of something being set aside exclusively for God's use. Holiness in this context means something set aside exclusively for God's use. The spices used here were very rare spices. They were very expensive. And we need to be careful here. There is, in some quarters, some places, a fashion for consecrating, anointing objects before God, setting them aside for God's use. And I think we need to be very, very careful before we take something like this and just slap it on something that we're doing in 2008. You've got to remember that what's going on here is not the anointing of some bright human idea. It's not that the Israelites sat down and thought, I know what we'll do. We'll have some priests. Oh, and we'll have a nice tent for them to do their stuff in. And we'll have that bit over there, and we'll use these colours. I know what would be nice. Why don't we make a nice smelling oil, and we'll use that. You know, what went on here was God said, this is how you build the tent. This is its measurements. This is the fabric you use. This is the metal you use here. This is the colours you use, and this is what you put inside, and this is what you put outside, and this is, so this is an anointing of what God has specifically and clearly laid out, something that was made and constructed exactly according to God's design. And these are holy things we're dealing with here. And we need to be very careful before we think, oh, let's just take that and apply that over here, because this is deeply holy stuff here. Let's read the next few verses, the last few verses of chapter 30. The Lord said to Moses, take fragrant spices, gum, resin, onycha and galbanum, and pure frankincense, all in equal amounts, and make a fragrant blend of incense, the work of a perfumer. It is to be salted and pure and sacred. Grind some of it to powder and place it in front of the testimony in the tent of meeting where I will meet with you. It shall be most holy to you. Do not make any incense with this formula, for whoever... for yourselves, consider it holy to the Lord. Whoever makes it any like it to enjoy its fragrance must be cut off from the people. Yet again, we've got something else that is being made from really expensive ingredients. Some of these ingredients were only found at that time in India. So they're being brought. They've been brought into Egypt, first of all, of course, and then brought over. So we're talking about something that is very, very expensive indeed. The salt was probably added to it for its symbolic value. Someone was asking me this week about the phrase, the covenant of salt. And there is this use of salt in the Old Testament because salt was seen as something that was permanent. And so it marked a permanent friendship or a permanent relationship. And here it was added to mark maybe as a sign of a permanent covenant. Let's go into chapter 31, and we're going to spend a little while in the first part of this chapter. Something very significant here for us. The Lord said to Moses, see, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with skill, ability, and knowledge in all kinds of crafts, to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, to engage in all kinds of craftsmanship. Moreover, I have appointed Eliab of Ahisamach, I'll get that right, my teeth are loose this morning, of the tribe of Dan to help him. And I've given skill to all the craftsmen to make everything I have commanded you. The tent of meeting, the ark of testimony with the atonement cover on it, and all the other furnishings of the tent. The table and its articles, the pure gold lampstand and all its accessories, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering, all its utensils, the basin with its stand, and also their woven garments, both the sacred garments for Aaron, the priests, the garments for his sons, where they serve as priests, the anointing oil and fragrant incense for the holy place. They are to make them just as I commanded you. Now, if you're a member of the broader leadership group here, could you stand, please? Remember the broader leadership group? Could you stand? I'm going to wander around, not all of you, but some of you, and just ask you a question. Richard, what job do you do to earn money?
I'm an accountant.
So that involves computer work, manipulating numbers. Do you work with clients at all?
Yeah.
Steve, leaving aside the work you do for the church, you've got another job. What do you do?
I own a furniture company.
And what do you actually do? You don't make the furniture. What do you actually do?
What do I do?
You do.
I get work in and contacts in to the company.
Ismat, what do you do?
I'm a contracts manager.
Okay, what sort of contracts?
Construction industry.
What sort of things do you build?
Movable walls.
Movable wall. Want a movable wall? That's your man. Timmy, what do you do?
I'm an accountant.
I won't ask you the same questions. What do you do, Liz?
I'm a pensions administrator.
Pensions administrator.
I'm a teacher. A 7 to 8 year old is very lively and they keep me on my toes.
7 to 8 year old teacher. What did you do? You just retired, Rangina. It's all right for some. What did you do?
I was a nurse and a manager.
A nurse and a manager. Okay, we'll keep going round. Lorraine?
I'm a college lecturer.
Nursery practitioner.
A nursery practitioner. Someone's got the language, haven't they? And I've got a couple more over here. I know you've just sort of retired. What were you doing before?
I was a customer care manager.
Customer care manager. Jibs?
I'm hospital consultant.
A hospital consultant. Before you started doing what you're doing now, you were a?
Used car salesman.
Used car salesman. And I've missed a couple over here. Before you retired, what did you do?
Teaching English as a foreign language.
And you've not quite retired yet, have you? You've just retired. Before you retired, what did you do?
A bookkeeper in a care home for older people.
Okay, do sit down. Thank you very much. What I find fascinating about this passage here, you see, a lot of people make, I think, a wrong distinction between sacred work, which is what they assume that I do, and secular work, which is what, as you've heard, most of the leadership in the church do. And they make a distinction and say, well, obviously what someone like David does and now what Warren does, obviously this is sacred, this is holy, this is something that God's Spirit can be at work in them and so on. But other people, they just do ordinary jobs. What I find striking here, look at verse 3. Look at verse 3. I have filled him. This is Old Testament, okay? The Holy Spirit was rarely given to anybody in the Old Testament. You know, we think about it, you know, people, the judges were endowed with the Spirit, Solomon, the prophets, but very few people were empowered by the Holy Spirit. Look who's empowered here. I have filled him with the Spirit of God, with skill, ability, and knowledge in all kinds of crafts. So here, empowered by God's Spirit, we have got carpentry, weaving, working as a chemist, a smithy, drawing, all of these enabled and empowered by the Spirit of God. You see, there is actually no distinction in God's eyes between the sort of work that I do and the work that any of the others that you've heard from this morning does. They're all equally serving God in full-time Christian ministry. I could have picked on other people in the congregation, but because they're part of the leadership, they're up for being picked on. So, you know, that they sign up for that. But I could have gone around and asked everybody here, what do you do? And everything that you do, actually, is something which God equips and enables you to do. Broader leaders, stand up again. Here's the question. I'll ask it once, and then you could just tell me as you go around. In your job that you do or did, if you're retired, just one sentence. How does God's Spirit equip you to do what you do? Okay? Think about that. Some of you got slightly longer to think than others. Richard's got no time at all.
It's very easy. It helps me very much to sort out very complex problems.
Talk to me about God.
I daily prayed for God's wisdom.
Linking with people and finding out what their needs are. showing God's love to the older people.
Helps me to mix figures with dealing with people.
Being compassionate to the recently bereaved.
Giving me broad shoulders to keep up with very difficult people.
Same again, difficult people, but giving me that knowledge to manage them with honesty and integrity.
He gives me the skills, knowledge and patience to develop poor young teenagers for future careers.
Wisdom and ability to deal with people in all situations.
Helping local residents with intractable problems.
Give me strength and peace and calmness.
Carls, it gave me the ability to read people and to negotiate with them fairly.
Okay, thank you. Do sit down. Thank you very much. In the list of spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians 12, one of the things that I find really striking is you've got this list of, you know, speaking in tongues and prophecy and all of this thing. And just chucked in the mix, you've got the gift of, in 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 28, the gift of administration. You know, we think, well, speaking in tongues, prophecy, raising the dead, all of that is deeply spiritual. Administration. It's in the same list. All of these things enabled and empowered by God's Spirit. And that's God's intention. If we see that in the Old Testament, how much more for us today? Amen? So in your situation, whatever it is that you are doing, whether you are a homemaker, a student, any professional career, that we've talked about this morning, I could go around to many, many others here. In those situations, God's Spirit equips you and enables you, gives you the gifts you need to do what you're doing there. And that's just as much spiritual service for God as what you might think that I do or what Warren does now. I'm going to pick on Warren for a moment. Yeah, stand up, yeah, because then they can see you. I'm just going to pick up, because you've just crossed this divide, haven't you? You've gone from what, you know, used car salesman. I mean, you hear that, you want to go boo, don't you, really? I mean, you know, used car salesman. So you've gone from being a used car salesman, yep, to actually now working full-time for us at church here as my assistant here. I no warning of this, all right? So you don't know what's coming now. Now, I'd like you to make a comparison about serving God. Okay, these two very different lives, one you left just 2 months ago to come and do this. You know, people might well be thinking there, okay, well, used car salesman. Okay, I mean, that really isn't serving God. What you're doing now, that is obviously serving God because you're working full-time for the church. How would you make that comparison for you? Nice, easy question.
It is. I was serving God there just as much as I am here. It's no
different. You are serving God there just as much as you are here.
Because I'm still dealing with people, and people are what's important to God, and, you know, wanting to see the very best for them. So the people in my old job that didn't know Jesus, I wanted them to come to see Jesus through me in the way that I negotiated, the way we dealt. And the same goes here. In the way that I would deal with people or spend time with them, I want them to see God for their best as well. So that's no, to me, there's no difference in that respect.
Which would you say, here's a really hard question, okay? Which would you say you see God using you more in?
The honest answer is, I don't see him using me any differently. There's no more or less, it's the same.
That's what I expected you to say. That completely unrehearsed, unbriefed. You see the point here, and I'm really wanting to drill at this because it is such an important thing that we need to take hold of about our lives. Often when I'm visiting people, sometimes when I'm seeing people and talking about their lives, they are frustrated with the fact that they are spending all their lives doing whatever it is that they are doing, to which they get paid to do. And if only they had more time to serve God. And it's a wrong parallel. That isn't how life is. That's not how God sees it. Amen? Let's come on to the last part of this chapter, verse 12. The Lord said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, you must observe my Sabbaths. They will be a sign between me and you for the generations to come, so that you may know that I am the Lord who makes you holy. Observe the Sabbath because it is holy to you. Anyone who desecrates it must be put to death. Whoever does any work on that day must be cut off from his people. For 6 days work is to be done, but the seventh day is a day of Sabbath, it's a Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whoever does any work on the Sabbath day must be put to death. The Israelites are to observe the Sabbath, celebrating it for the generations to come as a lasting covenant. It will be for a sign between me and the Israelites forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he abstained from work and rested." Now, we previously looked at the Sabbath, including the way it was a sign of God's people's special relationship with him, in detail some months ago. So I don't want to repeat any of that today. If you weren't here for that, you can find it in the series. It's there on the website. But what I want to reflect on is why God is saying that here. You see, again, I think it's really significant, and it's significant for us for a reason I'll come to in a moment. God has just, for the last, he didn't do it in chapters, but for the last chunk of chapters, has given a whole list of work to do to the people. I mean, a massive, great list, because none of this stuff's been built yet. You know, the tabernacle, the altar, all of these bits we've looked at, it's all got to be done. The work's not started yet. Moses is still up the mountain getting instructions. The people don't know a word of it yet. And at the end of that long list, the last thing that God says, almost, is, by the way, don't forget about the Sabbath. Don't forget about, you need to honor this day off. And the principle that is there is that just because we are doing God's work does not mean that we can sit loose on God's word. For them, just because they had this huge pile of work to do, all this stuff that God was saying didn't mean that they could work a 7 day week. Because God said, you take 1 day off in 7. So how does that apply to us? Well, I want to take it away from the Sabbath. We looked at that, as I say, previously. But I heard a testimony. I was at a conference some years ago, and I actually can't remember, mercifully, I can't remember who it was that was talking. So this isn't aimed at anybody in particular, but if they're watching this on the internet and want to repent, that's fine. They were giving a testimony at this conference, and they were they'd been going somewhere. It wasn't a big conference, it was a small one. They were going somewhere, and they were running late, so they were driving at some ridiculous speed on the motorway. I don't remember what it was exactly, but it was some, you know, it was over 100 miles an hour on the motorway. And they were saying that some people might believe that because I was speeding, the angels of God left me. They said, but because I was on the way to an appointment, I know that's when the angels came with me to speed me on my way. I thought to myself, that is complete and total garbage. What arrogant nonsense. Without even digging in to find out why it was they were late, I heard another testimony recently, which was very recent, so I won't tell the story. It's a bit too close. And some of you were there in the meeting as well and heard the story. Just because we're doing God's work does not mean that we can ignore God's laws. And God says to us that we keep the laws of the land. Yeah? Very, very clear. We keep the laws of the land unless they conflict with God's laws. And I don't think that keeping to 70 on the motorway actually conflicts with God's laws. Not as far as I'm aware. There's not, you know, it's not immoral to drive at 70. It's not disobedient to God to stay below the speed limit, is it? So why is it sometimes that Christians think that? Because they're serving God, they can actually sin while they're doing it. I mean, I could pick loads of other illustrations as well. I've heard similar arguments for people not paying taxes that they're supposed to pay. You know, so that they have more money to serve God. I don't think so. I mean, it's about as moral as going into a shop and stealing to say that I've got more money to serve God. Because actually the taxes don't belong to you, they belong to the government. You see the principle here? So we have the same thing here in Exodus. The danger, the temptation for them was, because they had all this stuff to do for God, that they might actually forget that God had said, and one day in seven, you rest. And so for us, just because God is calling us to do something, it doesn't mean that we can sit on the other things that God has said to us. And then we come to this final verse, verse 18. When the Lord finished speaking to Moses on Mount Sinai, he gave him the two tablets of the testimony, the tablets of stone inscribed by the finger of God. Probably on those two tablets was just the 10 words that we began this passage with, the 10 commandments. So with that, we leave Exodus. We will return to Exodus in the new year, and we'll come back to the mess that Moses was met with as he came down the mountain. Because whilst he'd been with God, the people had been somewhere else. So we'll pick that up when we come back in January. So let's think about this morning. What are the key things that we take away from these two chapters for us about our lives? What are the key things that affect the way that we live this week, this month? Mary?
It came to me that when you were talking about the laver, just before Jesus instituted the bread and the wine, he said to his, he washed their feet. Mm. And he said to Peter, if I don't wash you, you can have no part with me. And then Peter said, wash all of me. And he said, no, but you must have your feet washed. And this is like us, isn't it, as priests?
Very good. A lot of people do make that direct parallel, actually, between that the bronze basin, the laver, and that passage in the upper room in John 13, isn't it, where he washes the disciples' feet. And there is that disciple, you know, wash all of me. No, it's just your feet. It's that thing about holiness there. Yes, Anita.
Regarding the laws of the commandments that in Jesus, he also says in the New Testament, if you love me and keep my commandments and endure to the end, you will be saved.
Yes, very good. Yes, there's the whole thing about loving and linking with keeping commandments. They're not alternatives. Very good. Fiona?
At times we can kind of, like, because of where we are, we've come to know God as a father figure, and at times we have to remember that actually we've got to fear him at times because he is holier than we realise, and it's a privilege every time we go and speak to him, and we need to just remember exactly who he is and what he stands for.
Very good. He may be our heavenly father, but he is a holy God also. What else? What else do we take away from today? Andy?
Whatever we do it for God.
Whatever we do for God. Absolutely. Every part. Birch? Okay, we obey his words, whatever he says, we do it, and he will meet with us wherever we are. Joan?
Do you remember that conference we went to where, no, it was a prayer day, and people had different prayer places, and there was an altar for us to go and pray, and there were two girls organising it, and each had thought they would bring some incense sticks, and neither of them did. But as people prayed there, everyone said, oh, what a lovely smell of incense. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
You do. And so our praying is incense going up to God.
Excellent. Thank you. Here's Matt.
Everyone has to make his own decision.
Yeah. Everyone has to make their own decision. I don't know which of you had that. I just saw a hand in my...
Yes, I was just about to say, making a commitment to God is an individual affair, just like Ismark said. Your loved ones or your family, they cannot make that commitment for you. And no matter how much work you have, you need to create time for God.
Thank you very much indeed. Four things that I pulled out which reflect those things: needing to pay the price, needing to stay holy, God's Spirit enabling us for every aspect of life, and also just that reminder that rest is vital for us. Let's stand. Let me pray for you as we finish this morning. Father God, we thank you that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. We thank you, Father God, that all of our life matters to you. Every aspect, every component, every little part matters to you. And more than that, that your Spirit in our lives equips and enables us, every part and every aspect. Father God, thank you. Father, I ask that you'll help us this week, whatever we're doing, wherever we are, whatever place we're at, to know your Spirit enabling and equipping us. Help us too, Father, to practice holiness, that we stay clean as your priests, clean before you. That you can work through us in every situation we're in, every context we find ourselves. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.